It's the True Achievements Podcast, Gamescom Special. We are in Cologne. And it's beautifully sunny. Glorious day. A bit too warm, to be honest, to be traipsing around 22,000 steps today. Today was the first day, trade day, of Gamescom 2016. We have played a lot of AAA stuff. We've been focusing on the show floor today. And we've played a lot of games already. Two, four, six, nine games.
Wow.
Nine games already. Dave, it's your first Gamescom?
Yeah.
What were your first impressions?
Mahoosive. Very big. Can't believe the size of it. Just the sheer number of screens, games available.
Mm.
And everything from the smallest little game you've never heard of to the biggest AAA.
Mm. Yeah. So we got down there first thing this morning. They've obviously, given their current climate, given a bit more security than normal. So all the bags were checked on the way, which meant it was a bit more of a... took a bit longer to get in than normal, but that was cool. But we were pretty much in on the dot at 9 o'clock. And we started off by playing the traditional FIFA challenge. So we walked straight up to the EA stand in the public area, which was enormous, as usual. No queue at all, jumped straight onto FIFA. And having three of us there, actually, which I thought was going to be a bit annoying, it was actually perfect because I got to play Dave, two games head-to-head, and Jack got to play the journey mode. So, quick talk about the regular head-to-head mode. Did it feel any different to you?
I noticed a couple of differences. You know, they were talking about the players like backing in and using the body.
I noticed that too.
And the corners and the throw-ins with the directional thing was new.
So that's made a real difference. You can actually target the point where you're going to whip the free kick or the corner in, which makes you get an actual crosshair in the box, which is really nice. Which is definitely easier, yeah. And the players felt weightier. You can actually use their body weight to shield the ball and stuff like that, which was cool. It felt like they turned a little bit slower.
Yeah, it did feel a bit heavier, control-wise.
And Dave won the first game 1-0, and I won the second game 1-0, so all square. So we'll have to have a final on PES tomorrow. Yeah. We're playing PES tomorrow. Jack, what did you make of the journey mode? Quick disclaimer, Jack is not a football fan in any regard, so this is...
I'm a massive football fan.
You've kept that very quiet. Managed to keep that incredibly quiet. How was it? Obviously, we saw a little trailer for it at E3.
So it's actually surprisingly good. I'm not, as you said, not a big football fan, but it just seemed to add a bit more substance to the game. And it was, I don't know if it was the very start of a journey mode or if it was just kind of dumping you in the middle. But initially the player walked in and then you saw, I think it was a Man United shirt.
Yeah.
And then you ended up, you were a substitution halfway through a game and you played from that point forward.
Okay, I think that is right at the beginning then.
It's quite interesting, gave you a couple of different challenges to try and meet in the game. So one of them was to win the game, which I don't think you got anything for, but one of them was to pass 10 times.
Okay, nice.
And you kind of built up some respect with your manager in that.
Okay, cool.
So that's quite cool. And then it interspersed it with like a Mass Effect style dialogue. It was a bit weird.
Oh, really? Dialogue trees. Okay.
So you've got three different choices. One of them's like a middle ground choice.
Mm-hmm.
One of them's a fiery choice, and one of them's a cool choice.
Let me guess what you chose, Jack. Did you press the I'm not sure button?
Yeah.
Press all three.
Surely
in the middle ground option. Did you score?
Yes.
Won the game?
Yeah.
Oh, so you've actually scored more than either of us.
That was quite cool. You could actually pick to play just as Alex Hunter.
Yeah.
Or play as the entire team. So.
Okay. And what did you do?
So I played as the entire team.
Okay, cool. So for me, that whole mode, I'm really excited about playing. FIFA for me is, at the moment, I don't really like playing online because I'm not good enough to win any games. So FIFA for me is just like rattle through, try and get as many achievements as possible in the first sort of 10 hours before I get bored with it. But this will give it a proper, make it feel like a proper single player game for me.
Yeah, definitely. I think, like, for me, it's probably a pick up and play game. You play 10 minutes of it and then put it down. Mm-hmm. But this, it adds some proper substance to it.
Cool. Okay. We won't do like EA did last night on their on their live stream and spend another hour talking about foot. We'll go straight on to what we played next, which was next door to FIFA, and that was Titanfall 2, which I'd completely forgotten about that it was even going to be here, and then it was just there. So it was on PlayStation. FIFA was on Xbox, so that was no problem for all of us. Dave struggled a little bit with the controller.
Yeah,
It's weird because I've got a PlayStation 4, but I don't play it that often. But I don't really struggle with the controls anymore. I thought it was far worse with the PlayStation 3 when they used to put the trigger, always had the triggers on the bumpers for some reason, which was just really annoying.
In terms of the general buttons, it was okay. I'm used to the left thumbstick being off and to the side of it.
Okay.
So I kept pressing the D-pad instead of...
I kept trying to push the pause button and then tapping the side of a touchpad on the front of it and... All sorts of random stuff is happening. I only have a share screen at one point.
Oh, excellent. So, Titanfall 2. We were pretty much thrust straight in the game, weren't we, I think?
Yeah.
Dave, you're a big Titanfall fan.
Yes.
How did it feel to you?
There was nothing groundbreakingly new that I'd noticed. I think some of the abilities are tied to what loadout you've got, and because it was just at the start, you just had the default loadouts, didn't you?
Yeah.
So you didn't really get a chance to play with much of the new stuff. The one thing I did notice is it seemed to take ages for the Titan to come. Do you know, you got a countdown timer.
I didn't get one at all.
Well, I got one probably about a minute before the end of the match. It was, 15 minutes? Maybe 10, 15 minutes? But yeah, it's pretty same. Similar as before.
I really struggled with... the loadout that I was given. I couldn't work out how to change the loadout at all. And I was finding that I'd get into a one-on-one situation and empty, 50 bullets into the bloke's head, and he wouldn't die, and then he'd just shoot me about 3 times and I'd die. So I sort of figured out my gun wasn't very good after about the 8th death. And I thought, right, I'm not just going to respawn straight away. I'm going to actually try and figure out how to change my loadout. So I switched from a support class to an actual assault class.
Right.
And then I got 5 kills in a row. So it was like a complete turnabout. So I think that obviously choosing your loadout is and your class is really important.
I think the graphics look better than last time.
Yeah, for sure.
Are you still using... Is it a new engine? Are they still using SARS?
Not too sure.
But it definitely looked prettier. And there didn't seem to be as many... Do you know, like the grunts, like the AI control grunts?
I didn't see any of them.
No, exactly. So I'm not sure whether it's just that mode we were in or...
What mode were we playing? It was like a capture the area.
Yeah, it was like a domination type thing.
You had to amp up area, didn't you?
I didn't really bother with any of that.
I did notice as well, you used to get burn cards, do you remember them in the first one? And they were you get an amped weapon. Whereas if you got a bit of a kill streak going, it'd automatically amp the weapon you got.
Right.
So it just did that.
Like a bit of a merge between COD and that respect, isn't it? Putting some stuff from that.
Cool. Okay, so then we went to play Battlefield, but they weren't showing it at that point. So we then headed off backstage to EA, to their trade area, which was impressive as ever. It might even have been bigger than the show floor area. It was huge. They've got a lovely free bar in there. And we booked in to see, again, something that I didn't know was going to be there, which was Battlefront Death Star, which is a new DLC expansion pack that will be available... I can't remember...
September,
okay. And it's for Season Pass holders.
She did mention that, yeah. She did mention Season Pass.
I assume it'd come to non-Season Pass holders for a cost as well.
Well, you'd hope so, wouldn't you? She said it came in 3 stages. So the first stage is a space battle, X-Wings versus TIE Fighters...
Yeah.
TIE Fighters are trying to protect Star Destroyer, and obviously the Rebels are trying to blow it up. That was phase 1, that's the one we got to play. Then she said the second phase was inside the Death Star, where you're on foot, which sounded awesome. And then the third phase was a trench run, the famous Star Wars trench run, which I would imagine would be pretty sweet. But we were playing the first phase, which is the space battle. I was a TIE Fighter. What side were you guys on?
We were on the Rebels.
Yeah. My team won, naturally.
Yeah.
I really enjoyed it. I loved it. I got a feel of it straight away. Had no problem with the controls. For the first 5 seconds, I realised the stick was inverted, so I flipped that back. And then straight away, I was right into it. I got a lot of kills and barely died at all. I don't know if I was shooting bots I think there were
some, I think,
some AI enemies, and some of the guys I was attacking didn't seem particularly keen to get out of the way, so they may well have been bots. I also took out the Millennium Falcon, which was pretty cool. That took a hell of a lot of bullets before it went. But it was cool. The sound was great, as you'd expect from the Battlefront game.
Did you change your view from outside the vehicle to inside?
No, I didn't even know you could do that.
If you push down on the D-pad.
Okay.
And then the other directions are evasive moves.
Yeah, I noticed
that. Ah, yes. Yeah, I accidentally pressed one of them at some point.
The thing that was amazing about the cockpit view, though, was just the subtle sound changes. It actually sounded like you were in a cockpit, which you don't think about until you're playing like that, I suppose, but it's good.
I thought it was excellent. I really enjoyed it. I haven't played Battlefront since it first came out. I don't even think I own it. I played it on EA Access. This could tempt me to get it again. I thought it was excellent. Then we moved on to Battlefield 1, which a lot of people will be excited about.
Yeah.
We watched a video initially, which told us about what the mode we were going to play and about some of the new elite classes, which I didn't get to play any of them. Could you choose them? But some of the elite classes look wicked. There's like a flame-throwing dude. There was a guy with like just covered in armor.
Oh, a big minigun.
Yeah, and then like a proper minigun nutter. But I didn't get to play any of those. It was like a domination thing. There were three points or 2 points. The 2 points, apple and butter.
Yeah, it was
the weirdest thing. A and B on the map, but she'd go like, apple has been captured. Or butter is under attack. It's like, shut up, you weirdo. Again, I struggled with the default loadout I had, and I switched to a scout, which is like a sniper dude, and then I just hung back and just picked people off, and that was really satisfying. You could take people out from a really long way away. I didn't get to ride on any horses. Did you ride on any horses?
I got on one.
Did you? How was it?
It was good, actually. It worked just really well. So I was just running at kind of small ledges, and it was just automatically jumping over them, and a couple of headshots from there.
Oh, wow.
A horse.
Wow,
nice. Impressive.
Into the back of the horse's head? Or
actual enemies?
And then on the video, they mentioned this train, which I think most people have seen on the trailers, which actually, they showed it in a bit more detail. It looked amazing. They called it the Behemoth.
Yeah.
But that didn't appear, which is a bit annoying.
The weather, though.
Oh, yeah, the weather. So lots of wind, kicked up lots of sand.
It made it near impossible to see.
Yeah.
It was just fantastic, the amount it changed for the map.
It did really change the map, and the destructible environments are even more destructible than ever. I mean, there was buildings that I was sniping from that just disappeared from under my feet a couple of times. It was pretty scary. But yeah, I really enjoyed that. I think it's going to be a good game.
Is it 64 players in a map?
Is it?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, we didn't have that many.
No, we had quite a few. 10v10, I think.
Yeah, there was 20, yeah. But that was excellent. I really enjoyed it. So look out for that one. Then we headed back to the show floor and went over to the Xbox stand, where they had... It was a smaller, considerably smaller Xbox stand than normal, but they were still showing quite a lot of games. The first thing we did was head towards Forza Horizon 3, which obviously is quite exciting for me to play, given Forza Horizon 2 is one of my favourite games ever. And it didn't disappoint. We started off... Actually, I was playing the PC version, which was interesting. Yeah. But I imagine it looks identical to the Xbox one. Started off in a Lamborghini, and then sort of halfway through driving around, a monster truck sort of appears, and then you take over that. And the difference in the handling was, you know, really noticeable.
Yeah.
But also both felt great to drive. The Lamborghini was on the road, and then the monster truck went off-road and onto the beach through some water and stuff. That was really smart. And then we did a showcase event where you were in like a sand dune buggy thing, sand buggy thing, against a helicopter carrying a Jeep underneath it on a winch. And as the guy said who was introducing the showcase, just because it's Forza, just because it's Horizon, which is... good a reason as any, but that was really good fun. So the cool thing about the showcase events, as anyone that's played Forza before will know, is that you're pretty much neck and neck for most of it, and it's only when you get to the end that you can sort of accelerate away and win it. So you've got this helicopter sort of zigzagging over your head, and there's a few things, little moments throughout the showcase that are really smart. Like he clips this hoarding, and that sort of flies across the road in front of you at one point.
That reminded me a little bit of Split Second.
Yeah, which was a great... That was Disney, wasn't it? It was a really good game. And then there was another awesome bit where you took off a little jump.
That was brilliant.
And it just went... The camera cut to the side, it went slow-mo, and you were just like almost hitting the Jeep as you both fly across each other's paths. That was really cool. And then got to the end, and I won.
I won too.
Three wins!
I won with manual gears, though.
Oh yeah, Jack, you went to manual gears. Tell us about that.
So I went to manual gears, turned off the traction control and turned off the ABS.
Wow. So proper.
And brake, well, I have a braking line on, so I failed in that respect. But,
wow, that's good effort.
Yeah, it was really good, though. It was a beautiful looking game as well.
Yeah, stunning.
Some of the water animations, when you went through, like when you're on the beach and you go through like a little bit, catch the edge of the water, it's beautiful.
Part halfway through a track where you go down for a ford.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was really good.
Yeah. So I reacted with disappointment when I saw the price of the digital Ultimate Edition, which is £80. Which is about $110, I would say.
I guess so, yeah.
Something like that. For that, you get the normal game, you get a couple of car packs, you get the season pass,
play a couple of games early.
Play 3 days early. It's like, oh man.
Which you are going
to
do.
Which I'm going to do. This is annoying. I was hoping I was going to hate it and suck and save 80 quid. But Playground are taking my money. So thumbs up for Forza Horizon 3, it was excellent. And a really nice demo as well, really well done.
Yeah, good soundtrack as well.
Oh, yes, it started off with Churches, can't remember what song it is, but absolutely brilliant tune. And I think LFO was on there as well, which is a classic house tune as well. But yeah, it sounds like the soundtrack's going to be excellent as well. Then Jack and I went and played some Dead Rising 4, which was... They've changed the control system a little bit.
Yeah, so they've flipped around a couple of the buttons. So I think in the last one, you used to push the A button and then push X in the air to jump kick, and they've now switched the kick into Y, which was a little bit confusing initially.
Yeah, so that was like a melee, wasn't it?
Yeah.
And then you had... did you have that enormous weapon?
You started off with like a double-headed axe.
Yeah, double-headed axe wound. That you just smash around. It's got like lightning that comes out of it, and it just clears zombies like you're scything them, isn't it? It's really smart. And every time you get 25 kills with it, you can do an ultimate
move.
Yeah, you press Y and B together, and you just like plants it into the ground, and this like forks of lightning just cascade out of the top of it and just wipe out everything in the area. It was really cool. And unfortunately, it was only like a 5 minute demo. I could quite happily have played that for another 10-15 minutes to really get into it. I did rescue someone, and then I went and found something else. But even in only 5 minutes, I killed 292 zombies. It gives you a little counter at the end for how many you'd killed. So that's pretty good. And I was playing it in German, which made it harder. That's harder. While we were playing Dead Rising 4, Dave went off to see...
WWE 2K17.
And how was that?
We were supposed to have a hands-on, but they... got some issues with the consoles that they've got set up in like the little press area. So it was just a presentation, and it was very, you know, whenever a game that's like an annual release, they come out and they say, this is the most excited we've ever been. This has ever been. And I honestly, I was looking at it and I thought, it doesn't look great in terms of general graphics. Like the 2K games, like NBA stuff, look amazing. Mm.
Yeah, they do. They really do.
And the WWE one just didn't look
Frostbite,
particularly great.
Yeah.
But I'd never played the WWE game, so I don't... But they were talking about, you know, going fighting off in the locker rooms and all this kind of crazy
I've
stuff.
Never played one either. I imagine they're quite a good laugh.
Quite a lot of it was to do with... What's he called? The guy who's on the front cover. The massive guy.
He's like the
UFC fighter as well. I can't remember his name. Brock Lesnar.
Brock Lesnar.
Yeah. Okay. So a lot of it was kind of focused around him and, you know, why he's the cover star.
Mm.
But if you are at Gamescom, they've got Goldberg, a wrestler who's going to be here in the next couple of days.
Okay.
On the on like the public stand and stuff. But
great, I'll give him a little wrestle. So, not a must-buy for you yet?
No, I never fancied the games. It did look I think fighting games in general, like UFC and boxing, they always look kind of wooden.
Yeah.
And it looked very much like that.
It's difficult to get a fluidity there, isn't it?
Yeah.
A sport like that is such like close combat and close quarters.
Yeah, it looks. But yeah, if you're into wrestling, it's the best they've ever done, apparently.
If you like WWE, yeah. This is the best one you can get. While you were doing that, Jack and I wandered off to play some Gears of War 4.
Mm-hmm.
And for the first 2 minutes, it was just walking. I was like, oh, this is a waste of 2 minutes of my life. I want to get involved in some shooting. But eventually, we did get involved in some shooting. Quite a lot of, like, nasty, horrible enemies.
Yeah.
Pretty disgusting things coming out of, like, eggs, sort of hatching thing, like lava. It was pretty grim. And then your sort of standard grunts, scratch one grub, all that stuff. And it was more Gears. It just felt good. It felt chunky. Weapons felt great. The
visuals looked good.
Yeah, very pretty.
Did it have any of that, the level you played, did it have like the wind?
Yes.
Where it starts blowing at you.
And yeah, yeah, a lot of weather effects.
The sound was amazing at the end of that.
Yes.
It's almost like lightning bolt-esque. Mm. It hits the floor and then you've got to avoid these orbs that are flying out of it. And the audio was fantastic at that point.
Yeah, it wasn't anything groundbreaking. It was just more Gears.
Yeah.
Which is a good thing if you like Gears. So that was good fun. And then we actually, for the longest thing we queued up for all day, was Call of Duty Infinite Warfare.
It was an infinitely long queue.
It was infinitely long wait that we had as well. And so normally, in the 5 previous years I've come to Gamescom, you queue up for ages, and then they let in like loads of people. And I actually counted. So first of all, you queue up, and then they let in like a ton of people into a movie room, and you watch a film, and then you go out and you play the game, and you get like a good 15 minutes of film and a good 15 minutes of the game as well. So that was what I was expecting. 5 years in a row, that's what we've had. And as expected, we went straight through to the movie room, and they showed 2 levels of the regular single-player game. The first one was like a
meteor.
Yeah, it was quite weird. Like it was like, almost reminded me of Aliens. The film.
It was a bit Dead Space-esque.
Yeah, it was a bit Dead Space-esque. Yeah. So I think the premise was there's an asteroid which has got a mining unit on it, and they've gone dark, so no one knows what's happened. And you fly out to the asteroid to try and figure out what's happened, and the asteroid's spinning at such a rate that you can't go outside when it's in the sun because it's 900 degrees or something. So you have to sort of wait until it's in the on the dark side.
There's only a minute between the waits.
Yeah, it's very, very quick. And it was sort of, yeah, a bit Dead Spacey, as you say, like quite dark corridors, sort of torch lit, dead bodies lying all around, and they're not really sure what's happened. And then it just sort of suddenly changed into like a droid warfare thing. It went from really slow-paced wandering around this thing to like a rapid...
Suddenly a robot arm comes out.
Yeah, and then it was just rapid cuts for the whole of the next... sort of showing the whole of the rest of that level in like 10 seconds after having spent like 5 minutes building up to it. It was really weird. And that level didn't appeal to me one bit. The second one looked much better, I thought, which was old school Call of Duty... On the first of all, in a helicopter with a massive gun, flying around trying to rescue some people.
That was the COD 4 remastered.
Oh, okay, yeah. That was COD 4 remastered.
Yeah.
That looked really good.
Well, that's why I was so confused, because you queue up for Call of Duty Infinite Warfare, they show you 5 minutes of that and then 15 minutes of Call of Duty 4.
Yeah, I tell you what, Call of Duty 4 looks a good game.
That was an entire level they showed.
Yeah. Yeah.
I was thinking, oh, they're going to stop at the next checkpoint. I can remember this. Bit. Oh, just kept going.
Yeah, that looks amazing.
You got to buy the
Super
Special Edition to get that then.
Yeah. And then the nuke goes off, and then we're all sat there in the dark, and there's about 100 people in there, and suddenly this like raucous shriek. Really loud comes on the screen, and like a zombie head skull thing, as an introduction to zombies What was it called?
Zombieland.
Zombieland, okay. Zombies in Spaceland, right, okay, which is like the new zombie mode for this year, and it's set in the 80s, so you can imagine the music and the clothes are all massively 80s'd up. And it's for people, it's standard, I guess, standard zombies concept, but they just looked... Like, one of them had, like, a purple... One of the zombies had, like, a purple shell suit on. Yeah. It looked quality. Well, and that looked really good fun. Yeah, I thought that looked excellent.
Yeah.
So that, I presume that would be just part of the normal game. It's not DLC, is it? Okay. So then we were like, yes, that ended. And let's go and get our hands on some multiplayer. But what actually happened was, we walked out of the movie theatre into... Zombies in Spaceland. There was like three zombies wandering around with like lights for eyes. It was they were really well done, actually.
Yeah.
And then there was just loads of like old school 80s arcade cabinets everywhere with like rubbish versions of classic arcade games on them. And there was like air hockey and like basketball hoops. And then some like DJ bloke just playing music.
Trying to pump everybody up.
Yeah. Trying to get everyone excited. And then a raffle. You get given a raffle ticket and you went, it's like, where's the game?
German only raffle.
Yeah, well, and they read all the numbers. Fortunately, my my 1 year of German I did at school allowed me to translate the sequences of numbers that he was reading out to find that we didn't win any prizes at all in the time we were there. And that was just the most disappointing thing, because you just... They should tell you that there's no gameplay.
Especially, like, we queued for maybe 40 minutes, didn't we?
No, can't have been that long.
It was half an hour, 40 minutes.
Really?
Yeah, because Dave met us and we queued for another 10, didn't we, after that?
Wow, okay, so that was rubbish. So if you're in Gamescom and you want to play COD, you're not going to be able to, first of all, so don't bother getting in the queue unless you just want to see a movie, which is no doubt probably available on YouTube at the moment, or see some blokes dressed as zombies, which was just odd, and not win a raffle. So
really weird.
It was really weird, yes.
You can see the disappointment on everybody's faces when he walks out.
Yeah.
And the DJ's going, come on!
trying to make everyone excited. It's like, what? Where's the game? I'll tell you how you can get us excited. Put the game out here.
I was almost hoping that was going to be like a middle area. Yeah. File everybody through to the game.
Annoying. So that was Gamescom Day 1. We are just about to get ready for the Mafia 3 party. And then we have a ton of stuff lined up for tomorrow, including... the Xbox Fan Fest, which we've been lucky enough to secure invites. So thanks to Aaron Greenberg for sorting that out. We will get to play all the ID titles and all the other Xbox stuff that we haven't played today, which includes Sea of Thieves, Recore, Halo Wars 2, and probably a couple of other things that I can't remember off the top of my head. Apparently ID have 15 titles there. We didn't see any of those, so hopefully we'll get to see all of those tomorrow. And then we've got appointments pretty much all day. We've got a chock a day of seeing all sorts of different games from all sorts of different publishers. So tomorrow's pod will contain probably more information, I would imagine.
Yeah.
Although we'll probably be recording it before we go to the FanFest. So we probably won't cover any of that stuff. Anyway, thanks for joining us. We'll be back tomorrow, as I say. Happy Gamescom. Bye.
Bye.
Bye.